Welcome, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick, and this is World Footprints.
I had the pleasure of meeting our guest, Ben Von Wong, during a seminar with Photographers Without Borders. And Ben's artistry just captured me. And as you'll see, he is an extremely gifted visual artist, and he uses his gift to make positive impact.
And Ben says that his mission is to make that positive impact unforgettable. And he does this with the help from other skill sets, including martial arts and scuba diving. Ben, welcome, and we'll get into all of that stuff in just a moment. We understand you're in Montreal. How are things going there this evening?
Honestly, I haven't left more than a couple kilometers radius from where I am. So from where I stand, streets are quiet, just like everywhere else. You know, life is slow, but that's not a bad thing. So it's kind of hard to say. I feel like we're all on school break. It seems like it's about to end quite soon over here.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. They're looking at lowering the restrictions here and in many other places with schools reopening and so forth. So it'll be really interesting to see what happens over the next couple months.
So we're going to go through some of your photos in a moment. I hinted about the artistry, but I want to get your backstory first. You know, how you, from the time you picked up a camera until the time you added, I'd say, set direction to it, and then consciousness storytelling. How did you get to where you are now?
Yeah, I mean, I think the easiest way to describe the journey was just slowly, one step at a time. I have always just done things based on what my heart desires, in the sense that I had a day job. So photography was the side hustle. And in the beginning, it was just something that I could do to keep myself busy. And then over time, I realized, hey, I can earn a little bit of money doing this. So then I started buying more gear, and I was in events. And then events got me access to a whole bunch of things behind the scenes, which was great. And then as I got deeper into events, I realized I really like flashes, because I could start carving out different portraits and make those unique. And then as I started mastering flashes, I started looking towards special effects, and after special effects, and that just became these larger and larger sets, until eventually I kind of reached the top of that food chain, I suppose. I had a couple global campaigns. I did these big shoots underwater with people on fire on the edge of buildings. And those were all great, but it just felt like something was missing. Although I was inspiring people with the process, it felt like the end result itself didn't have much purpose to it. And I think that was a gap that I wanted to close. And so sometime in 2016 is when I was like, all right, I want to figure out how to add more purpose and meaning into the work that I create. How can I do that? And it took a long time.
Now, you and I both have martial arts in common, and I understand that martial arts movement informs your photography. Talk about that some.
Yeah, I mean, you know, life is kind of interesting. The skills that you acquire over time somehow manifest themselves in your life, and you might not even recognize those patterns. I did martial arts starting from some like age 3 or 4 or something, and I just always had like an affinity to motion after that. I can balance off of things. I'm not scared of heights. I like have a lot of trust in my body. At some point I did some parkour, which then evolved into like stunt work. And then I did some capoeira. So I've had the opportunity to kind of cruise between different disciplines, including actually even like capoeira led to breakdance. And so like this idea of dance and movement and the body is something that I think you'll see a lot inside of my older work, especially this idea of how you would position a person within the space, how the body should look, and, you know, learning from being in those spaces that ultimately the dancers are the best people to actually consult to figure out, well, does this pose look good? Can you do it better? And they're going to nitpick to the ends of the earth, just to make that photo better for them as much as for me. So, you know, you never really know how the skills that you acquire earlier in your life can really play themselves out. But I definitely do feel that in the same way that one might pursue diversity in the workplace, you also want to pursue the same diversity in your life so that you can introduce new concepts, so that these concepts can come together and make idea babies, and then really unique things can happen based on your lived experiences.
Well, and let's take a look at some of your idea babies. And
so this is a mermaid on 10,000 plastic bottles. Those are 10,000 plastic bottles that were destined for a recycle facility that we intercepted, borrowed, cleaned, delabeled, and then laid out in a series of different patterns. The project was born after my mom saw a mermaid tail online that was in Montreal. And she's like, hey, you might like this mermaid tail designer. I was like, oh, wow, her stuff is so awesome. I want to work with her, but how can I tie impact into it, right? And so I was thinking, well, mermaids live in the ocean. What are problems in the ocean? Oh, ocean plastics is a big thing. It's a Great Pacific Garbage Patch. It was really hot at the time. It had just kind of gotten unveiled. And I was like, why don't I do a photo shoot that connects those two problems?
You mentioned the ocean, and one thing that you and I have in common, we're both scuba divers.
Yeah, this photo shoot was actually done significantly after my first photo shoot. So the first time that I went underwater diving was in Bali. This is it's not the second, but it was the first kind of activism driven one. So I had figured that since I already knew how to tie a model underwater, why not up it and make it a little bit more difficult by tying a model underwater with sharks swimming around? And so this photo shoot was shot in Fiji. It happened the day after it happened during a photography workshop, or rather right after a photography workshop. I figured that since I had a trip to Fiji to teach, why don't I take the time to look around and see what issues is this region tackling and how might I contribute?
Now, Ben, you travel all over the world for your photo shoots. How have your travels informed some of the visions that you've had for your photos?
Yeah, I'm an extrinsically inspired person, meaning that I am inspired to do projects based on the people I see and talk to, the places I visit, and the things that I do. And so if I just stayed at home, which I am doing right now, it gets really hard to stay creative because there's no like influx of inspiration, which I need in order to like bounce off of it. I'm a little bit more like, I guess, like a bouncy ball. And so the places that I visit, generally speaking, you know, will help to shape whatever it is that I'm trying to do because they inform the opportunity. So yeah, like this project, for example, on lava, happened because I was in Hawaii, right? I was in Hawaii and I was like, I am already here. I want to do something. I want to make the most out of the opportunity. What could I possibly do? And I found a friend of mine, CJ Kale. He organizes lava walks and lava tours. And I was like, can we go do a photo shoot on lava? I've never done it before. The motivation here was to highlight sort of the indigenous warnings that the world was going to end soon. But I think I didn't do a particularly great job on this one conceptually, but it was still a really, really wonderful experience.
Now, speaking of that conceptual process, is this something that you would sketch out ahead of time? Kind of walk us through how you get to this point.
I think in the past, all I needed was like a cool outfit, and then I just would go to the place, and then I'd bring my own lighting, and we just figure it out there. But nowadays, it's harder. And I think especially with impact, it's not even about creating a good image anymore. It's about creating an image that's going to have the outcome that you're looking for. You're not just trying to produce an image. And so getting into impact as just like a field has been extremely complicated because you need to really think through what it is you're trying to say, why you're saying it, who you're going to be helping, how you're going to actually measure that. And all of these like extra questions that have nothing to do with the actual creation of the image itself.
And I want to go to another photo that really, really resonated with me.
Yeah, so this series was called Strawpocalypse, but more kind of colloquially, it's the parting of the plastic sea, and the plastic sea made out of 168,000 plastic straws. I mean, we're all familiar with this idea of the seas parting to let the Jews escape Egypt. And I just thought it was a really powerful reference for people to think back to. I think that humans are, you know, we have a lot of innate programming based on the culture in which we grew up in. And that familiarity is something that we can relate to a little bit. And so anytime I have the opportunity to relate to something that people have seen or that's culturally relevant, I try to do that. Mm-hmm. And in this piece itself, it's made out of 168,000 plastic straws that were collected over 9 months. by an organization called Zero Waste Saigon. And to be completely honest, I didn't even think about what the photo was going to look like. I was 110% focused on building the thing, because I figured that if I built the thing right, I'd figure out how to take a photograph, right? I think with the stuff that I do, as it's gotten bigger and more complex, the challenge has to be to stay relatable, because I want people to know that at the end of the day, this was still built with the help of volunteers, just hundreds of volunteers that came, that collected, that cleaned the straws. We did some experiments to figure out what would make the straws look good. And then we just kind of found the people who could help us build it. Like, it's not a superpower as much as it is just a lot of hours of stress in order to bring one of these projects to life. And so, you know, the whole purpose of what I do, I think, is to inspire a conversation and to start one. And yes, I have like the intention of saying like our plastic consumption habits are a problem. There is only so much you can do, but there is something you can do. And maybe it is time to get corporations to become more accountable, but that's just like one facet of it, right? You know, plastics is just one symptom of a greater problem. You know, plastic affects the poorer countries way more than it does us for now. We all share an ocean, but like, you know, there's a socio-economical component to it. There's a poverty issue to it. There's an education issue to it. I mean, we look at the Sustainable Development Goals as 17 different pillars, but really you can't just focus on one at the detriment of another. You know, even the projects that I create, I'm flying to different places to create them. I'm burning carbon. I use plastic too from time to time. I mean, you can't avoid it. And so ultimately it's almost the sense that like we all have to stand up and do something. There's a really great saying, which is that, you know, we don't need the entire world to go vegan. We just need everyone to eat less meat. And I think that's really the crux of a lot of the social societal problems that we have. It's about getting everyone to stand up and do their part to the best of their ability to make sure no one gets left behind, and to like also keep an eye out on the things that you're not even paying attention to, because the road to hell is paved with good intentions.